This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Hey, hey, Marcus, House with you here. Happy New Year to you all, and welcome to the first episode of 2021. We are jumping straight in with this week's Starship developments and SN9 poised for its first flight test over the upcoming week. A bizarre announcement by Elon Musk on the Super Heavy 2, so stick around for that one. We take a look at another successful launch for Ariane Space with the CSO2 mission, and we also have some progress updates on the latest SLS green run test of the core stage. Starship SN9 is currently tracking an early 2021 launch for what will be a similar flight to SN8, with the main goal of aiming for a smoother landing. With the vehicle already on the launch mount, the first test on Monday involved filling the tanks with gaseous nitrogen to test for any leaks or anomalies in the vehicle. Then on Tuesday, it underwent a full cryo-proof test where all four tanks were filled and pressurized with super cold liquid nitrogen. Also seen during its testing window were RCS tests firing one at a time. These tests verified that the vehicle was sound, paving the way for the three-engine static fire test that should occur over the next few days. If that test is successful, this will prove that the trio of Raptors performs as expected. At this stage, we have no reason to believe further tests will be needed until the 12.5-kilometer test flight, and that should soon follow. If this plan holds, this is a highly expedited test schedule compared to SN8, which underwent 5 static fire tests and sat on the pad for 2.5 months ahead of its launch. Looking back to that flight of SN8, I'm sure many of you, like myself, spent a great deal of time trying to guess how the historic flight would go. I'm sure by now most of you know the basics. We had liftoff, rise to the 12.5 kilometers, belly flop, controlled descent, flip and land, but there were many aspects of the flight that were a surprise to us. The three Raptor engines that took SN8 into the sky can produce up to 6,500 kilonewtons of thrust, over 80% of an entire Falcon 9 rocket. That was more than enough thrust to get Starship Serial Number 8 to that 12.5 kilometer altitude extremely quickly. However, that is not what SpaceX did. If you remember, the ascent was extremely slow compared to a normal rocket launch. As the vehicle continued to climb, engines were intentionally shut off to further reduce thrust. This was done to reduce the thrust to weight ratio as the tanks emptied, further reducing the overall velocity and stresses on the vehicle. As the flight of SN9 creeps up on us, we are back to the speculation. How will the flight of SN9 differ from SN8? Remember, SN9 is the first Starship to be constructed entirely using 304L stainless steel alloy. SN8 had some, but it also contained an older alloy as well. Since this newer 304L steel is theoretically stronger, SpaceX might be more comfortable putting more stress on the SN9 vehicle. This could mean a lot of differences, from a faster takeoff and ascent to possibly cutting off the individual engines earlier in the flight. All of these changes would also affect the amount of fuel left in the tanks and how much fuel they would need for the launch in the first place. Granted, all of this is simply speculation at this point. The flight of SN9 may look perfectly identical to SN8 with hopefully a slightly smoother landing. Either way, it is going to be exciting. Will the flight look the same, or will it be changed in some way? Let me know what your thoughts are in the comments below. Now, I've just got to shout out this brand new video here by Corey2. I'm only showing here a few lower resolution snapshots of the predicted Starship flight based on what we've seen with SN8. There is a link in the description to check out the full video with all of the amazing audio as well, so make sure you're following Corey there. There is a lot more coming. Now, in the past, I haven't done a lot of live streaming as I've had significant trouble with internet connectivity. Interestingly though, we've just had some repairs done here, which will hopefully make it a lot more stable. So yes, I'm hoping to live stream that event here on YouTube with you all so that we can watch and talk about the flight together. Just keep an eye on the channel here, as that is where we'll announce the stream time. If you want more frequent updates on that, you can follow me on Twitter with the link in the description as well. Now, another exciting little piece of information recently dropped, with Elon Musk providing a quick update on the expected schedule for the BN1 Super Heavy. Here he said that the hop will take place in a few months. Elon previously noted that the Super Heavy booster will initially conduct a 150-meter hop and that the booster will fly with two Raptors. It's unknown whether or not this holds true, as he tweeted this a couple of months ago now. However, we haven't received any new information, so we still believe this to be the plan for Super Heavy BN1. Talking about that first Super Heavy booster prototype, it is believed that the stacking will soon start up again now that SN9 has been moved to the pad. Numerous sections are ready for stacking now, perhaps even all of the core sections are ready. Furthermore, RGV aerial photography managed to capture a very clear view inside of the high bay, showing the sections that have already been assembled, while the remaining sections are located outside in the production area. In this capture here, we can see a stack of 8 rings on the left, believed to be the forward dome and part of the methane tank. On the right is an unknown 4-ring stack. Could SpaceX be stacking the upper and lower sections separately with the final assembly of these two at the end to complete the booster? Let me know what you think in the comments as well. Now, we have seen as well new beams being hoisted into the high bay roof area, which is likely, I think, related to the gantry crane that Elon mentioned while replying to a tweet earlier by Brenton. This gantry crane will be utilized to complete the stacking of the Super Heavy booster inside the high bay. Of course, that could have been very useful to stop the SN9 tilting over and smashing into the high bay walls, so that can't come soon enough. On Tuesday, SN10's nose cone sporting those fins was moved from the low bay and into the high bay ahead of stacking operations with the main tank section. Furthermore, SN11's aft section was rolled into the mid bay with the forward section being stacked on top just days later, completing SN11's entire tank section. This completed nose cone inside one of the tents is believed to be for SN11, so it shouldn't be too long until we see that prototype fully complete as well. I mean, how crazy is this progress that we're seeing right now? Perhaps Elon Musk's tweets last week about multiple starships coming soon to Pad A and Pad B was really referring to SN10 and 11. I must admit, I didn't think for a second that SN9 could be ready to fly so soon. It's going to be very fun to see how all of this evolves over the next few weeks. Now, what could be the start of a brand new test tank was seen around the facility as well. Mary, aka Boca Chica Gal with NASA Spaceflight, as always out there on site, diligently shooting away, capturing all of this wonderful detail. We can see here the forward dome was sleeved with only one ring, and an aft dome was sleeved with a stack of 2 rings. In the past, this has been a pretty good indication of the beginnings of a test tank. Again, time will tell. So here we are at the end of another week with Brendan's diagram updated from the last one. Here is what it looked like on December 19th, and this is what it looks like now. You can scrub back and forth here to compare the many changes that have occurred here in that short time, but I've highlighted a few of these here in blue. Thanks, Brendan, for keeping us up to date there. Make sure you're following his feed there on Twitter if you want to have these diagrams even earlier. Now, Elon Musk late this week tweeted some quite extraordinary information about the Super Heavy, and at this point the 3D artists out there are going bananas trying to figure out how the heck this will work. We'll talk about that more in a moment, but first a big thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring this video. Skillshare is a huge online learning community made up of thousands of curious people. You can find almost any creative subject you are interested in, and boom, there you are, increasing your skills and getting a deeper knowledge of related skills you didn't even know you were missing. It is a brand new year, and what better time to bring color, beauty, and fun into 2021. By joining up, you can now try one of Skillshare's new live classes. Of course, there is a magnitude of existing content to digest as well. Your interests may lie in website development, it could be in animation or video production, you name it. Now, through 2020, you probably noticed a few elements like these little widgets that I do here for credits and other ones like this, and these are actually motion graphic templates built using After Effects, and these can be really handy when used in Premiere, which is the software used to edit these videos down. In this course, Jake Bartlett taught me how to get started making these very same motion graphic templates. If you'd like to know how to do this and even more advanced stuff, he will walk you through how to use the Essential Graphics panel in After Effects to build customizable controls for your design. It really does improve your editing workflow a great deal. Now, there is a little coding in this, but don't panic. It isn't as daunting as you first might think. Once you learn how to do the basics in your projects, you'll never look back. Skillshare is organized specifically for learning with no ads interrupting you. It's also incredibly affordable at less than $10 a month with an annual subscription. If you'd like to help support me and you'd like to give it a try, the first 1,000 people will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium Membership. Just follow the link in the description below. So yes, the Super Heavy Booster. Now just take a look at this tweet here. This is yet another beautiful animation by Eric showing a potential Super Heavy descent profile. The question here to Elon was asked how accurate this may be, to which Elon replied saying that SpaceX are going to catch this massive booster with the launch tower arm. Now, just wait on a minute here. I think this had most of us doing a double take there because this sounds like some futuristic sci-fi stuff. SpaceX, however, do have quite the habit of making sci-fi a reality. Previously, of course, it was proposed that the booster could at some point land directly on the launch mount, which seemed bizarre enough. But catching it right out of the air under the grid fins there with those taking the load, that just sounds nuts. And how far down the track are we talking here? We really have no idea, but let's just think about this for a moment. Provided that the Super Heavy booster can land with the near pinpoint accuracy that we see with Falcon 9, we can imagine the booster decelerating to near zero velocity just as it's within the reach of the tower arms, however they're going to work. Now these arms would then clamp in from both sides somewhere underneath those massive grid fins and then close off. This example from Corey here is a potential option that we think would work really well. Two arms come in from the side with huge shock absorbers built in. At this point, perhaps the arms fully take the load as the engines shut off and the launch tower simply lowers it back onto the launch pad. I mean, the rough dry mass of the Super Heavy from long ago was estimated at around 180 metric tons, and there would be a tiny percentage of propellant left on touchdown. Perhaps it is all a little lighter with the improvements made so far and without the legs, but this is not a small load that we are talking about. The bigger question in my mind is what happens in case of a failure? What if wind gusts or engine failures cause it to come down too hard or off center? As Elon later said, this could involve a few hiccups along the way. So yes, although legs would work perfectly well, the best part is no part. Reducing the mass of the booster allows greater payload to orbit. So yes, I want to know what all of you think about this. It is a nuts idea, and I'm sure there is much more to work out, so let me know your thoughts. Now, a few recent updates on the most recent green run test for the Artemis 1's core stage. The last test was conducted in late December and it was mostly successful in its goals. This test, number 7 of 8, was meant to verify that the article could fill up, maintain and drain the cryogenic liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen, which would allow SLS and NASA's engineers to move forward with the 8th and final green run test. This would be a full duration hot fire. However, this success didn't come without a few hurdles. SLS has gone through many challenges this past year ever since it was placed on the B2 test stand at NASA's Stennis Space Center. The seventh test continued on that trend when it attempted to complete its wet dress rehearsal. December 7th was the first shot at it, but at the beginning of liquid oxygen loading, SLS engineers encountered a problem while trying to chill and fill the first stage. That caused them to abruptly scrub that attempt. Now, just to add a little background, the sequence for loading up the tanks begins with liquid oxygen first, then once that tank is almost filled, the liquid hydrogen tank would then be loaded. This is due to liquid oxygen storing point being very cold at negative 183 degrees Celsius. However, liquid hydrogen is even colder at negative 253 degrees Celsius. To prevent thermal shock to the tanks, liquid oxygen is first run through the pipes to chill them, and then that is followed by a complete fill. Together, this can take a couple of hours to fully complete the sequence in preparation for a full hot fire. In that process, all four RS-25 engines fire up and will drain the entire core stage in only 8 minutes. Now, a few days after the failed attempt, information emerged that the liquid oxygen temperature stored in the facility was warmer than the accepted tolerance for the propellant tanks in the vehicle. This therefore shut down the entire loading process. Moving on from that, the second attempt was mostly successful with a few issues that were later considered within tolerance. This attempt was on December 20th and it went through all of the loading processes correctly, with the liquid oxygen temperature issue now being fixed and within the SLS's tank's tolerance, loading was completed and the SLS rocket was for the first time ever completely laden with cryogenic propellant weighing nearly 974 metric tons. That test did however end slightly early at T-4 minutes and 40 seconds as a hydrogen top-off valve didn't close properly in the terminal countdown nearing T-33 seconds. A hold was issued and after review the engineers deemed the test would end and safing then began with all of the liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen being unloaded. It does seem though that SLS and NASA engineers seem to be content with the results of this wet dress rehearsal with an official press release being posted the day after. With this test completed, we will surely be on the lookout for the final hot fire and once again be able to see the RS-25 engines roar to life. The last time we witnessed multiple engines firing together was back in 2011 with the final flight of Atlantis, STS-135. It's going to be exciting watching these beasts roar together in unison once again. Now, another successful launch on the Soyuz with a mission by Ariane Space, launching a new military reconnaissance satellite on Tuesday, December 29th, during the week. This was flight VS-25, and the CSO-2 satellite on board is the next generation of satellite created to conduct Earth imaging. Over time, these will replace France's existing Helios satellites. This was, of course, the last launch of the year for Ariane Space, and this CSO-2 satellite is the second out of three satellites that are going to be placed within a polar orbit. The first CSO-1 mission was launched 2 years ago in December of 2018. And these satellites are quite massive too. They are built by Airbus and they weigh in at around 3.5 metric tons or 7,800 pounds. Interestingly, the first of the three was set up in an orbit roughly 800 kilometers in altitude, whereas this latest one will sit a little over half that altitude at 480 kilometers. CSO-1 has a very respectable resolution of 35 centimeters from 800 kilometers in altitude, and they claim that CSO2 manages an incredible 20 centimeter resolution from around 500 kilometers in altitude, capturing both visible light and infrared. That is a pretty impressive amount of detail. In addition to that, these satellites have excellent capability to autonomously control their orbit, and they're also highly maneuverable. So yes, that mission, as far as we know, has gone to plan so far. Nice work there, everyone involved in that final launch for the year. Now, I just wanted to say a huge thank you to my amazing patrons here, along with each and every one of you watching, liking, and subscribing. We did meet that goal of 250,000 subscribers before the end of 2020. Thank you all so much. You all just blow my mind. On to 300,000 we go. There is just no way that we could have made the amount of content at the required frequency to achieve that without all of your support. Thank you, each and every one of you. As that support continues to increase, that helps the entire team. So if you like what we're doing and you'd like to join our awesome patrons here, head to patreon.com/MarcusHouse. That gives you access to interact with me more directly via the linked roles on our Discord server. You can have earlier access to the videos to watch before anyone else. You can also have your name listed right here like all of these other amazing people. A big thanks as well to the entire production team for all of the help with these videos and of course to the quality control squad here for helping me research and proof all of the material. If you're interested in these topics and you'd like to be a part of this, follow me on Twitter and please do get in touch. In the tile in the bottom left today, we have my video last week talking about SpaceX's final mission for 2020, which was of course the NROL-108 mission, along with, of course, Starship updates as well. In the top right is my latest video, and in the bottom right, content that YouTube has selected from my channel just for you. Thank you, everyone, for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.